What has Blade done?
That means we've lost trust in the law enforcement agents.
We've lost trust
in Blade.
For a long time.
We can't lose trust in the law enforcement agencies. Because that would mean I'm not safe right here where I'm sitting.
We're not safe.
Let's get rid of Blade.
We're not safe.
A practical example. When
for the first time in a very long time.
Yes.
South Africa is the only state to stand up and say we won.
That was nice. I thought that will be taught in history books.
I am proud of this country.
No, I thought that
so many countries have been discussing around the topic. Mm. So many things have happened. Russia, Ukraine wars.
Yes.
No country is bold enough to stand up and say no.
Yeah. There's no country which protects itself like America. Look at the imbalances. When America invaded Iraq, nothing was said. When America killed leaders, political leaders in Africa, nothing was said against it. When America invaded Afghanistan, it said it's defending itself against 9/11 attacks. There was no calls, let's go to the International Court of Justice. Mm. There was no calls that let there be violations, even against Bush. There's no call that he must go to the International Criminal Court. But when it comes to African leaders, immediately you do something wrong, then there are calls that you must be brought to jail, as it were.
It's a brand new episode of the GLC podcast. It's 2024, it's a brand new year, and I'm super excited to be doing and shooting a brand new style and version of what we want to do for 2024, right? For all of you who have been following what we've been doing, what we've been shooting, we want to take it to the next level in 2024, and I've got interesting people that are here with me in studio. It feels good to say in studio. So we're sitting down, and we'll be talking about a couple of things. I've got Max, I've got Upotlungile, and they are both phenomenal people that I've known for a long time. And they've got quite interesting views, which is why I think you guys, you're the perfect combination of people to be here today. But it's the GLC podcast, and we'll stream this on YouTube. It will be on Apple and all podcast streaming platforms. And we've got quite a number of things that we want to talk about today before we do an introduction of Amanda, Max, and Lungile. So there are quite a number of things that I wanted us to chat about, right? One of them is the South African thing in the International Court of Justice. Thanks for correcting me. I said International Criminal Court. International Court of Justice. So there's a lot to talk about there. There's a video that we want to play there. NSFAS crisis. I'm sure you guys have heard about what's going on there and stuff like that. There's lots to talk about there. I'm not sure if you guys have listened to the recordings or not. Not really.
Some of the clips, but I think the clips are about 2 hours long.
Yeah.
It's a bit difficult to listen to everything.
Yeah. So there's that to talk about. Should the minister resign? This whole thing of free higher education. I know that that discussion maybe it's been what's the right English word?
Ongoing.
Not ongoing, but over
redundant
or over discussed or what? But I want us to look at that. I think you were SRC deputy president,
or SRC. I was the chairperson in the Eastern Cape.
Chairperson.
In the Eastern Cape at UNISA for the SRC.
Sure. And Bele, you've never been involved in student politics.
Well, it depends on your level of involvement. If leadership is involvement, then no.
Metsong.
But it's always been active. I've always, I'm not going to say, but everybody knows. I mean, dude, back then in like your 2013s, I was on posters, especially as a law rep when Tando and I went head to head.
Oh, yeah.
I've got a good one. That was a nice run. But I've always had certain political views. Never really believed in leading in politics, but I think they've been embedded.
Why not?
Not per se leadership. I don't think that leading in politics is something that everyone endeavors for, because naturally that's what propels you, especially student politics. A lot of people use it as a springboard to step into other national aspirations or grow into other areas. So I was always conscious of that. And I think my belief was largely invested in student community at the time. And we needed to make this space a space that, you know, both living and learning aspects could be opened up to the greater student community.
So
leading wasn't my thing.
So, yeah, no, there's a lot to talk about. Lenduka and as fast, ne?
Yeah.
Should Blade Demande resign? Will we have, I think for me here, the biggest thing, which I'd love to hear what you guys think, will we have another FISMAS fall in 2024? Will we have another FISMAS fall? Why? Because there's this fee increment, ne? Not increasement, yeah. Fee yeah. increment, ne?
No.
That the minister now has announced, I think a couple of days ago. So, and then Jacob Zuma and his breakaway MK party. I think a lot of people are talking about that. I just saw something earlier on that said, Lizzo Jim posted something on Facebook. He was saying, not sure if you know Lizzo Jim.
Yes.
He was SRC president for three or four consecutive terms of 40. But he posted something along the lines of there being about, I think, 7 million site visits, like MK website.
Yeah.
That there was something like that, 7 million site visits.
That happens in South Africa. Yeah. You know, when something is hot off the press, everyone kind of marches towards it, but site visits don't guarantee votes. we have to draw that distinction. You know, you can never really make those comparisons. Those are far and wide comparisons.
There's a lot to talk about there. Ace Magasule joins, I think I saw that on your news. Mm-hmm. Ndongane, the name of his party?
The African Congress for Transformation.
African Congress. They've merged now with the MK party. So I don't know what that means now for the political landscape. But yeah, there's so much to talk. And then 2024 elections. I'd love to hear what you guys think about 2024 elections. Who should people be voting for? Mm-hmm. There's an article here that I've got. You guys can have a look at that. That just speaks about the voter registration numbers. I think it was published last year.
Okay.
And how there is a huge influx of young people. It's a nice dynamic. Young people now are registering to vote. So what does that mean now for the big four, big five, or for all of those political parties? And how should people be voting? I think that's something we can discuss. How should people be voting in 24? Not who should people vote,
how?
But how should we, what should we be looking for?
Definitely.
I've put that on the table because Jonas and I had this discussion about what all of the political parties represent in terms of their ideological perspective.
Yeah.
And how people on the ground in most cases don't vote ideologically, but they vote based on, I don't know,
emotional circumstance.
Yeah, yeah, stuff
history,
like that.
I mean, we live in a country that has so much that's up in the air. So, you know, to vote based on that is a difficult one. Eh?
Yeah. So, and then maybe two other things. Fikile Mbalula, some of his recent comments that he's been making, he's been in the news. Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? There are some people that are saying, hey, he's the worst ANCSG that people have seen in ages. But I don't know. I don't know what you guys think. You know, is it good? And then to finish it off, I want us to just look at a couple of books that you guys would recommend for 2024. We're starting the year. We want people to read. We want people to be informed and educated and empowered. We don't just want people. And I think this is why this platform, or this is what we want this platform to be. We want it to be a platform where people are encouraged, educated, inspired to go and start and build and contribute to society, not just to be entertained. So that's it. That's what I'd like us to look at. But first, introductions. Max, let's start with you. Introduction, who's Max Ubele? I know you, a lot of people know you, but maybe some people that might watch would not know who Max is.
Yeah, I know. Look, thanks for the platform, man, and it's my first episode being out here. Took you quite a minute, I must say. But I'm really, really excited. And I think these conversations are ones that will become a breath of fresh air for a lot of people, not just in the Eastern Cape, because we're based in the Eastern Cape, but I think just in general South Africa, because these are real life South African issues that we'll be touching on a day-to-day basis. And it's honestly my belief that when we get into the crux of the matter, you know, we unlock so much conversation that I think South Africa should be having. So with that, my introduction is simple as that. I'm basically a conversationist. I'm a person who engages a lot in these particular aspects. I'm a speaker, facilitator, and, you know, sometimes from time to time as a corporate MC. But other than that, yeah, I also do run my own business focused on something similar to that.
Yeah.
And I think I'll park it there.
You're the one guy I know who's made lots of money from MCing gigs in the Eastern Cape.
Apparently. I don't know. So we don't run a list. We don't have a database. And I don't think we're that interconnected in the Eastern Cape. But yeah, I've done a lot of gigs. And there's still a lot on the table to chow. So if anyone's looking for any of those services, I am available.
2024, what does it look like for you?
I mean, look, podcasting, a lot of public platforms, I think that for me is primarily important. But I think over and above everything, and I'll get to that when we talk about books, man.
Yeah.
It's all about being intentional about the moves that I make because they need to have some kind of financial reward. I think that for me is important. Money isn't everything, but I think this year it's highly on. It's top two or not two. That's all I'm going to say. Yeah, so that's where I am. But for anyone who does not know, and I think we're going to discuss this, one of the questions or one of the topics that we're discussing is the International Court of Justice in South Africa making an application there. Mm. And one of the people that was speaking there, Professor Dugard, is actually from Queen's College in Queenstown, and I went to Queen's College. So that's something. We were put on the map. They were well represented. So shout out to Prof. Dugard for that. And
I'm looking forward to the conversations, Max. I think you and I have done lots of stuff together. We did Vusi together.
Yeah.
We did DJ Spoo together in the Eastern Cape, in PE.
Yeah.
We've done some projects together. And and I've known you for how long now? 10 plus years.
10 plus,
I'm looking forward to the conversation. Potlungile, great to have you on board. Great to have you here. I think you've got a sharp mind. You know, the part of why I thought it would be good for you to be here was from ever since I've known you, I've always discovered about these youth educational platforms through you. Enke, Yali, what's the other one? Activate. I've always seen, and you know, even before something switched on in my mind, even before, but I've always seen them through you. So to people who don't know you, basic introduction, who are you, what do you do?
Yeah, so I'm coming from Mount Elif in the Eastern Cape, right? And through schooling, I've been able to attend schools in PE. I've been to NMU, I've been to UNISA in the Eastern Cape. The education space, that's always been the passion.
Sure.
Serving through Enke, building young people in terms of helping them create projects that can bring change in their communities. Also been part of Activate, being able to hold debates and be able to speak on topical issues.
Yeah.
And also help young people build their own businesses. And I've also been involved in the ministry space, the church space, and sort of trying to bring a change of mindset in that space where church is not just being in the four walls of the church.
Yeah.
We just need to get involved in society, be involved in politics, leadership. So that's something that I've also done academically to study through UNISA as well. And it's something that I push a lot of young people to say that's the space that we need to invade in order to be able to bring change in the country.
Which space is that?
The space of politics and leadership.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yes,
so
definitely.
There's a lot of vacuum when it comes to young people. That's a space that we are not adequately represented. Even now, if you can look at our topics in terms of politics, we're not really talking about young people. We're talking about the older generation.
Yeah, the freedom fighters.
Abo Jacob Zuma, Abo Isma Khashule. We're talking about Abo Blade in Zimande, the communists.
Yeah, yeah.
So the vacuum that I'm talking about is that we need to also start talking about young people and getting them to be represented 100%. And getting them to be involved. And they need to also become the voices that we are looking up to and also following in terms of the narrative and the conversations in the country.
That's interesting. Maybe in other episodes we can look at the conversation about the church, because I think there's a lot that we can talk about there. But let's get into it, gentlemen. International, not criminal court, but International Justice Court,
Court of Justice.
International Court of Justice. International Court of Justice. There are a couple of things I want us to look at there. What is it about? Maybe, Budlungile, you can tell us more about that. What is it about? The merit of the legal argument. I wanted us to look at that. I saw on Twitter, you are watching it yesterday. I watched bits and pieces of it. You are watching the proceedings yesterday. Yep. You're a law graduate, by the way, for people that don't know. You're a law graduate. So you are watching it yesterday. There's a short clip I want us to have a look at. I was only able to watch Advocate Tim Mekangcukai Thobi, who I think, man, that guy just blows me away.
Sure.
Just in terms of what he represents, in terms of his look as well. Mm. Like, in terms of his style.
It's not conventional, man. It's not conventional. Yeah. Just doesn't care. What he cares about is the profession. And I think for him as an individual, it's the first time lawyers of this generation have been so bold. And I saw someone write this about Twitter. Yes, they were commending the South African government, but they were saying these very people are the people that have challenged the government on numerous occasions.
Mm. Which people?
You know, the people on the panel. You look at
Adila. Yes,
she was involved. She's a director of Section 27. Who? Heavily involved in the Life SD Mene case. Adila.
Okay.
And then you have Tembekangcukai Thobi, who's been heavily involved in a number
from
of
the Eastern Cape, right?
Cases.
Yes, from the Eastern Cape, and also coming from an academic background from the Eastern Cape. So
also.
He's a pioneer. Yeah.
He's currently serving as the chair of council.
Actually. Yes.
Convocation.
Yeah. Convocation.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a lot to talk about there. I think let's start with that clip. I just want to show you guys the clip. And I also wanted us to talk about just in terms of what is it all about? I'm one of the people that really don't understand, like, what is this war about? What's happening? So South Africa is now gone to the International Court of Justice. What do they want? I know that they want, they are putting a case that says Israel is committing genocide. What are the implications of that globally, in terms of the global geopolitical landscape? What are we looking at in terms of now the West? Because I also saw something else, Max, that said India is supporting Israel, something to that effect. The US is supporting Israel and stuff like that. So in terms of the global geopolitical landscape, what does that look like? First, let's look at the clip. I'm just gonna try and get it on my phone here so that people can hear whilst we play it for you guys here in studio to hear. Let's play it here so that they can hear, and then we'll play it here as well.
Death and despair. Death and despair. In conclusion, Madam President, many propagators of grave atrocities have protested that they were misunderstood, that they did not mean what they said, and that their own words were taken out of context. What state would admit to a genocidal intent? Yet, the distinctive feature of this case has not been the silence as such, but the reiteration and repetition of genocidal speech throughout every sphere of state in Israel. We remind the court of the identity and authority of the genocidal inciters. The Prime Minister, the President, the Minister of Defense, the Minister of National Security, the Minister of Energy and Infrastructure, members of the Knesset, senior army officials, and foot soldiers. Genocidal utterances are therefore not out in the fringes. They are embodied in state policy. The intent to destroy is plainly understood by soldiers on the ground. It is also fully understood by some within the Israeli society, with the government facing criticism for allowing in any aid to Gaza on the basis that it is recanting on its promise to starve Palestinians. Any suggestion that Israeli officials did not mean what they said or were not fully understood by soldiers and civilians alike to mean what they said should be rejected by this court. The evidence of genocidal intent is not only chilling, it is also overwhelming and incontrovertible. Madam President, it is now my honor to request you to call.
Yeah, I was just playing it here so that the guys can hear. So what do you think? What do you guys think? What is happening? What, in fact, let's start with what is it? What's this all about?
South Africa's case, it's definitely an interesting and historic case, right? And it's a case that is followed by many states and many citizens in different countries. Mm. The interests of this case are, what is the influence of international humanitarian law? How does it really influence different nation states? So South Africa and Israel are both members of the United Nations. Mm-hmm. They are also bound by the conventions, by the rules within the United Nations. The International Court of Justice, whenever there is disputes between these nation states, whether these disputes are about violations of human rights, killings and failure of children, issues of humanitarian support, disputes that are lodged with the court, it becomes now the responsibility of the court to resolve those disputes. Now, South Africa has actually put up allegations and a dispute against Israel to say they've committed genocide, which is the killing of thousands within Palestine, and also the violations of the rights of parents, pregnant women, children. That's the issue. And the evidence that you see in the clip being presented was presented by the councils and the advocates of South Africa to show what is the genocide that has been committed by Israel. And Israel is supposed to respond to those allegations. And then we wait for the outcomes of the court, which may affect the war.
The implications, right, of... So the implications of... the International Court of Justice. I'm not sure if you guys have thought about this, but that's one thing that I thought about. Okay, so South Africa goes there. What if the court then says, yes, Israel has committed genocide? Then what then?
Yeah, I mean, look, there are a number of implications that can be involved. For instance, I think in South Africa, the EFF had tried to implement one of those implementations, which were, you know, sanctions against Israel.
Sanctions
against Israel, the same way that there was repatriation in the genocides that had happened in Hitler's time. So there would be repatriation for the loss of life of those people, both financially and otherwise. Obviously, jail time for the, is it five or six members that are implicated that were stated? The Prime Minister, the President,
Yeah.
It would be jail time for those. And naturally,
People could go to jail.
Yes,
which
of course.
Jail?
What do you mean?
Like, wait, where? Like,
you get tried now in, because genocide is a criminal act in the International Criminal Court. So that's where they would be tried. To my
understanding. Question is like, is there like, I know it doesn't really matter, but is there like an international jail that they would?
It's actually a good question, because like, everyone where wants they to go? Know.
Because if they committed a crime in South Africa, we know would send them to a jail in South Africa. But where do they go? These four
people,
or five.
Yeah, a lot of people are tried in their own countries where the act happened. Because what happens is you have to be tried in the country in which that act happened. But now that it's an public international law, opens that door openly, and the UN can come in and they can be tried at The Hague. And once they are tried and punished for whatever, then they can be jailed in their own countries.
In their own countries.
They can serve time in their own countries, yes.
Imagine Putin serving time in his own country. There was a whole thing.
Where else would he be tried? Because if he serves time in America, he's dead
tomorrow. I mean, who would arrest Putin in his own country? I don't know. I'm just trying to wrap my head around this
thing. No, I hear you, and it's a fair question. I mean, a lot of people are asking themselves that question. And, I mean, for me, honestly, who gets arrested? You know, something that I've been thinking about. In 1948, Israel gains their independence. This war has been going on for quite some time. But I think that's where, and if you hear some of the articulations that Tungukai Tobi was making around the time of 48, it's where all of this war intensified. Mm. And from there on, it has been happening in the Gaza Strip for a number of years, where obviously the border is both Egypt and I think towards the north, it's Israel. But it's still one of the two Palestine states. And that's where it intensified as a territorial war, and secondly, as a racist / genocidal war.
Let me ask a stupid question. What's the war about?
The war is definitely about land.
Initially.
Okay. Yes.
It was about land. But you can go on.
Yes, yes. Yeah. You are right. There are other interests at play. You can expound as well.
Yeah.
But when it comes to wars, there's always, I would say, the invisible hand. There's always other countries at the background which are almost like putting oil to the fire. And these are the countries that are causing tensions to be there between these countries, and who are always sort of like delaying a coming to an agreement. If you look at, like you've said, the Russia-Ukraine war, there's external parties. This war between Israel and Palestine, there's external parties. But it is about identity. It is about ownership of your own land. It is about reclaiming and rewriting history. And so those issues are at play. There's also, for me, issues of religion that are at play. You see this even in the rhetoric that is being used in the war, where people would take statements from the Quran, they would speak against Israel. Mm-hmm. Also on the other side, we would see Israel using statements from the Bible to speak up against Palestine. So there's also almost like ethnic and also division in terms of religions that are also at play within this war.
That's crazy.
No, I think you've definitely covered it. There were Jim Crow laws in America that oppressed black people from ownership of property, land, and the like. So in the areas in which Palestinians existed, you wouldn't sell property to them. You know, they wouldn't gain access to a number of things. And that's how you marginalize the people of Palestine existing within these small Israeli, you know, spaces of occupation. And it's become so, so difficult to really understand the root cause of this particular war, because it's been so diluted, you know, over the years. That's why I say initially it was over territory and land. But over the years, it's become such a racially, ethnically, religiously motivated war that keeps on going on. And it dies down for a number of time. But then obviously, like I say, there are forces at play that keep externalizing and feeding this. Because at the end of the day, what you must also understand is that Arab countries are largely resourced as well. So there is an economic benefit to the Gaza Strip.
Is not it just the oil thing or what?
There are a number of interests, both natural resources as well as just people fighting for identity and staking claim to this particular strip.
All right.
Because that's where the heart of the actual warfare is.
It's the Gaza Strip.
It's Gaza.
Which is a piece of land.
Yes.
That people are fighting over. Like, who does it? Does it belong to Israel or does it belong to Palestine? Is that the...
That's one of the main issues that is the reason why the war is going on. Because when it comes to Palestinians, they want to be recognized as a nation state.
Sure.
And Israel is not in support of that.
So what are they currently if they're not a nation state?
Well, their rights are very much limited in terms of where they are. The Israelites are in charge. The Israelite armies are also involved in terms of looking after their minerals, their wealth, their resources. So they are not taking decisions concerning their own land. And that's where the main issues are. And when it comes to Israel, they've always maintained that they are looking for a solution, but they've never given the Palestinians a solution. Mm-hmm. And that's why the war is unending. Mm-hmm. It's Israel's always maintained that they are for peace, but you never see peace coming to the table and being negotiated in good faith. And that's one of the main reasons that the war continues even up until this day.
Some interesting people for me that have come out before we move on to another thing. I think the reason why this is important, just on a basic level, is so that the lay person can get an understanding of like what is this thing about, because it's all over the news. And I think there are lots of people like me who don't really understand, like, what is the war about? What are the implications of whatever, in inverted commas, prayer that South Africa is making to the International Court of Justice? But I think some time ago, Mogoeng came out and he was a pro-Israel type of person. Am I correct? I think I saw something like that. I'm not sure if you know anything about that, but...
Yeah, if you can recall, he has been making biblical statements.
Sure.
Right? If you were to look at the Bible is pro-Israel. I mean, even God in the Bible is called the God of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. So when it comes to those of the Christian faith, they tend to take a pro-Israel approach in their statements. They speak for the prosperity of Israel. They speak for the peace of the land of Israel. And the issue that often comes into play is that the foreign policy of the South African government is not in favor of the actions of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
That's the main issue. You would have also remembered there was also a pageant where the former Miss South Africa, Ulalela,
Miss Universe, that was happening.
Had to go to and represent South Africa. And that pageant was going to be held in Israel, right? And the issues of the government was that we can't send one of us to represent us in Israel when we are not in favor.
In a state
of,
where we
and
condemn.
So the
which government?
The South African government withdrew the support and she went there on her own.
Mm. Yeah. Can we just think in this mic so that it's closer to your... Yes. Yeah. Maybe we must double click later on this, the Bible and it being pro-Israel thing, because that's also another interesting discussion. You know, because someone might say, but no, it's not the physical Israel, it's the spiritual Israel, which is the New Testament believer that the Bible is pro of. Not okay, it's a whole another discussion maybe that we can't have today. But what are your final comments on this thing? What should people be looking out for? What do you think? I think even today they are...
Israel's responding.
Oh, Israel is responding today.
Yeah, so they're presenting their oral arguments.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Have you watched?
No, it's going to be
interesting.
Today's been a busy day, and I think watching the response just in social media and the news, it's very disappointing to hear, you know, how people are so oblivious to their own crimes.
Mm.
And it's very painful to see that you stand in honor in defense of what you have. But, you know, commands were given. Statements were made, actions were conducted, and the genocide in itself, in terms of the genocide code, and these are obviously my closing remarks, that it's either one of those five crimes that are stated or acts that are stated in the genocide convention. And I think a large number of the discussions were based on Article 1 of the genocide convention, which largely prevents a state from committing genocide or puts an obligation on a state to prevent genocide from occurring. And I think a lot of people should acquaint themselves with that in terms of what a state does in order for itself to prevent genocide from happening in its own country.
Man.
And that's why we bring up issues such as Marikana as genocides. What should a state do? And that's why they're calling for the head of the president a number of the times. It's been over 10 years where we've discussed this issue. And that's why you ask yourself why. But the call wasn't from Ramaphosa. It was from the South African Police Commissioner, whatever the case may be. But a state has an obligation
to prevent
genocide from happening.
What I would also bring totally in disagreement is the fact that states are oblivious to genocide. Politics often have differing interests. One of the contentions that is brought by Israel is that we are defending ourselves. They hold that position because even Palestinians have been bombing Israelites. Even Hamas has also been killing Israelites. And the issues at play is that also nations have a responsibility to protect themselves against attacks. There's no country which protects itself like America. Look at the imbalances. When America invaded Iraq, nothing was said. When America killed leaders, political leaders in Africa, nothing was said against it. When America invaded Afghanistan, it said it's defending itself against 9/11 attacks. There was no calls, let's go to the International Court of Justice. There was no calls that let there be violations, even against Bush. There's no call that he must go to the International Criminal Court. But when it comes to African leaders, immediately you do something wrong, then there are calls that you must be brought to jail, as it were. So there are imbalances. But what I can put...
Imbalances...
In the law.
In the law.
And imbalances in terms of the perceptions of how different nations are being viewed. We view Israel maybe from a bias, a biblical lens. Because I'm a Christian, I think Israel is innocent. That's an imbalance. There are things that Israel has done which is wrong. My understanding is that the Bible doesn't condone killing. But Israel maintains that it has to kill.
In order to defend.
In order to, that to me is a contradiction. Also, at the same time, Palestinians are saying they need to defend their rights. But they are not using the law to defend their rights. They are using bombs. So that, to me, also doesn't sound balanced. That's why I'm saying in this whole war, there are imbalances that maybe even the South African government has not looked at. This is not just an easy case. It's a very difficult case to prove because you need to have evidence.
Two wrongs don't make a right.
Yes.
And there have been issues on both sides. You know, we've seen a number of Hamas leaders as well as, so it's been very tough. But for me, I have always and always and always maintained that at the end of the day, each and every country, insignificant of its act, needs to be brought to account. There are so many instances. You're speaking about Bush, man. Yo, his term was... it was a complex term of multiple warfare. And I understand America as a hegemonic state wanted to protect its own interests. But we need to be able to go back and look at those conversations and realize that, you know, so many clips have been out there where there weren't terrorists, where there weren't attacks, but yet there were still invasions in Afghanistan and Iraq.
A lot to look at, a lot to talk about. Let's move on from this because we can spend a lot of time on this Israel thing. So people should go and watch.
My advice is that no one at this particular stage is an expert on it. And we're all grasping at the knowledge that we have. And it's such a mammoth task.
Yeah.
But what we can all sit down and agree on is that for the first time in a very long time,
yes,
South Africa is the only state to stand up and say we will.
That was nice. I thought that will be taught in history books.
I am proud of this country.
No, I thought that
so
was.
So many countries have been discussing around the topic. So many things have happened. Russia, Ukraine wars.
Yes.
No country is bold enough to stand up and say no.
Yeah.
We need to account
we need to take other countries to account.
Wait. The Russia, I know we're not speaking about that. The Russia-Ukraine thing, there was a statement issued by, is it the International Criminal Court, that the president should be arrested.
Putin
should be arrested. Was there anyone who brought that application? Was there an application brought to the internet or to the International Criminal Court?
No, the UN. It wasn't the ICC. The UN says South Africa. Putin is visiting South Africa in
August. So you must go in.
So
arrest
as a member state.
Yeah,
arrest this fellow because yeah.
So it was the UN that
it requests South Africa to do such. And it's not an us problem. It's a you problem. You know?
Yeah. The other issue is, these agreements within international law, like the United Nations, they can bring a burden on South Africa to arrest someone. Mm-hmm. And you would see in certain countries, certain people not being arrested. But when it comes to Putin, there was an issue there that we had to arrest him in order to be compliant to international law. Mm-hmm. That's where the issues lie for me. And
otherwise, if you're not compliant, there are sanctions and stuff like that.
Exactly. You are also in breach as well of international law. Yeah. And this case might have certain implications of that nature, where based on this case, it might affect the relationship of South Africa and Israel.
Naturally.
Relationship
Definitely affected. You can already see that.
Yeah. Naturally, it will.
Yeah, it's an interesting one that people can go and read about. This NSFAS thing, let's move on. We spent a lot of time on this NSFAS thing. There's a couple of videos. I'm not even sure. We're not going to play the clips because of time. But I'm sure you guys have heard some of them. I listened to it today. I think you were saying, rightfully, that there's a two-hour recording and there's a 19-minute recording. I listened to about 3 or 4 minutes of it.
Yeah.
And in that recording is the chair of the NSFAS board that's speaking about, I think he was saying, in fact, let's play it so that people will play like a couple of seconds of it. And I want to hear what you guys, should Blade Zimande resign? Will we have another FISMAS fall? For me, that's the biggest thing. Like, man, are we going to have another? Because it looks like we're heading towards that direction, especially when it's called Xazibula now in February. Like, so I'm going to play this. It's a 42-second clip. I'm going to play it quickly so that you guys can just hear what we're talking about.
If the CEO wants to change the decision that we're taking, he's fighting.
You know? I don't think they'll change.
Those things, I saw the letters. Yesterday he was asking me whether I must take his laptop or not. I said, are you crazy? Why do I take your things? So, if he raises this, it's okay. But I saw the letters. As a matter of fact, I have contributed in shaping the letters. I added a few things.
What letters are those? We don't know. So that was the, I think some people are saying, no, these things have been tampered with. It's not legitimate, blah, 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 blah. But I'm sure you guys also saw that. I think now he's taken leave of absence, the chair of the NSFAS board. And I'm not sure how Dr. Blade Zimande is implicated in that. I've not done some reading, but I'm not sure if you guys have looked at this. Whether you have any comments, do you think he should resign? Do you think, what do you make of this thing, this NSFAS board debacle and the corruption allegations and all of that? Max, what do you think?
I think everyone at NSFAS should resign.
You
know, honestly speaking, if we are really being honest, we have a country and we need to be very strict about and prudent about the things that
the whole
really
board
matter.
Or
whole board.
Or you're saying shut down NSFAS?
Whole board, not shut down NSFAS. It's a powerful tool that can really shape. You know, education is one of the only tools that can help someone move from one strata to the other.
Sure.
I have seen it personally liberate a lot of families.
Yeah.
And if we can really take it at one of the pillars that South Africa really holds close, if it's social welfare, if it's education and healthcare, are one of the most important things that this country needs. And if you have a group of individuals that are representing the interests of young people, NSFAS should operate like a development agency where it is able to access foreign funds, where it is able to mobilize individuals.
Do they have that component now of raising foreign funds in order to, or do they just take
from
been
support,
the government?
But largely it comes from the government, where in the budget speech it is allocated to higher education.
So you're saying the whole board must just resign?
I honestly feel as if we can fail in a lot of things. If we speak about electricity, all of these components are contained in the Bill of Rights. But for me personally, the things that steal one's dignity and the things that can build and shape a country should be in the hands of people that have aspirations to do that. And I have not seen that being echoed in NSFAS. As the single biggest public funder of young people, you exist in a country, in a continent, that has the biggest demographic of people under the age of 25. So you are talking largely about the existence of young people. Yeah. And young people want to be educated. If we can get right the educational aspirations of young people, so I'm not too concerned about the corruption allegations. What I'm concerned is NSFAS as a functional entity.
You're saying they're failing.
Or as a functional organization, they're failing. But remember again, we're speaking about young people. So what I think is failing is the pressure firstly on the government to ensure that NSFAS operates for its intended purpose.
Uh-huh.
Secondly, how did we get an application to Israel? Or rather to the International Court of Justice? We place pressure on a entity to make a ruling on a particular issue. So there are organizations that are there that have the power to place pressure on NSFAS to get itself in check.
So you're saying they're failing because they're not funding as many
young
people?
No, they're not functional.
How are they not functional?
NSFAS has centralized all the funding currently. Back then, it used to be dispersed to multiple universities and they'd be responsible for the administration and rolling it out. Now it's been centralized back to NSFAS, and NSFAS is failing to operate in a particular manner that allows students, one, to gain access, even if you have been funded. There are students sitting in TVETs, there are students sitting in universities where NSFAS has not been allocated yet. Firstly, students have to gain money in order for them to register. NSFAS doesn't disperse that money before. Why? When people are open, when there are financial officers that are there to release that, when there are grant officers, these people work to press buttons, to release funding to students. Students have been accepted. Students need to register. Universities have now had to wiggle their way around creating registration exemptions. You know, but private residences don't have the space to create an exemption for 2 months because I need that money. I'm renting a private residence, and if a student is there and their NSFAS was funded, then it means at the end of the day, they need to be able to pay that. You find students being kicked out. But yet these people have produced a letter that has gone to the university and that has been sent straight to NSFAS to say, I am in a private accommodation that is NSFAS accredited and I require you to pay X, Y amount. There are students who use that money to even feed families, not just themselves, back at home.
So we need to understand
the gravity of the role that NSFAS plays.
So you're saying they're not efficient.
Bigger learning experience.
Get rid of the board.
They're not efficient. Get rid of the board.
This thing doesn't matter. This corruption thing.
It does matter because it just points out just how careless.
It has exposed the
just
tiny
how
bit.
Careless.
Yeah.
This whole system is around the future of young, and forgive me for saying this, black people, because a large number of those who apply for NSFAS are black people based on qualification. Mm-hmm. No, I say, you know, I don't want to just become exclusive to black people because I am black and I adhere to matters of black people strongly. But at the end of the day, we need to be realistic about the matter. These are aspirations of children who want to acquire higher education, who want to acquire skills. And it is something that we should be championing.
Your thoughts on this? I'm going to read this now just before you speak. This was a news article on the 9th of January. News 24 published this and I've printed it for you guys. Blade Zamane has proposed tuition and residences fee increases of 4.5% and 6.5% respectfully for universities. Now, pause there. I'm not sure how long it's been since these things have been increased, because the last time I followed this was when President Jacob Zuma said there's no fee increase increment, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure how long it's been since then until now. That was when 2015, 2016. Yep. I'm not sure if anything has increased between then and now. But this is what the Minister of Higher Education is saying. And in this article, you know, it speaks about so many things that I think would be valuable for people to read up when it comes to this conversation. It speaks about the missing middle, you know, missing middle being those people that earn between 350 and 500,000 rand. It speaks about how much money is going to TVET colleges. For me, that was interesting. How much money? The fact that Department of Higher Education, I think, is spending, I think this was last year, right? 5.5 billion was available for 26 universities and around 681.2 million available for 50 TVET colleges. Now, look at that ratio. When it comes to universities, I don't know why there's that type of distinction, but there's so much to look into when it comes to this. What do you think in terms of this?
Yeah, the issues are interlinked. Like, the matters that are happening at NASFAS are also part of what I would say the crisis that we're having in higher education. For the past couple of years, since fees must fall, we've been having a crisis.
That was 2015,
where,
right?
Yes.
Fees must fall.
The fees in institutions are growing in terms of you are being costed more to study, you are being costed more for textbooks. It costs more now to stay in private or whether residential institutions within the university. So the reality is that most students are no longer affording higher education, and the support or subsidies that are coming from government are no longer enough for the universities to be sustainable and to meet their expenses, and for universities to also be able to meet the demands of their learners. That's the main issue. With NASFAS collapsing, it would really mean that universities also collapse. And that's where the issue is.
Link. Yeah.
So, but for me, I would not entirely support a stepping down of the board or of the minister just yet, because within the system, there's also been some successes.
Like what?
Some of the successes, for instance, they converted NASFAS from a loan into a bursary. Meaning that you no longer pay it back if we pay for your tuition, if we pay for your accommodation. Now it's a free bursary and a full bursary.
That's something that was at the top of my mind, and it was going to be a discussion point. but I want you to continue.
Yeah. So for me, some of those conversions must be seen as successes, because remember what a pain it used to be to be a graduate, but you are owing NASFAS. That used to be
so
a pain.
It's a full-fledged
bursary. It's a fully
now.
Fledged bursary.
Since when?
Since 2018. Since 2018. And so the system has been running and the system has been performing, but there's always allegations of corruption. And I think one of the weaknesses in the country is that we are not strong enough in investigating allegations of this nature. And these allegations never result into any arrests.
Yeah.
That's why, for me, I never support any stepping down of the board. Because now, let's make an example. I stepped down. 3 years later, there's no outcome.
And
you
shifted.
Become the board member.
Exactly. You step down, you go somewhere else.
Yeah.
Of course.
And then you replicate that same behavior.
It happened
there's no accountability.
Exactly. So there's never accountability and there's never an outcome. And for me, even when the law firm is coming in to draw up a report, there's never any arrest. But millions were given to the law firm to investigate the issue.
But the thing is, now we're in a situation where there are also state entities that are, you know, being manipulated. You know, we've got SIU, and those need to be investigative and intelligence units that work towards uncovering these things. You know, we've got turn two, and I think Kimi Magwetu used to say this, the South Africans,
who?
Or rather the government, the former Auditor General, he's now late, Kimi Magwetu used to say, you know, we've gotten to a point as a country where we are too too absorbed in outsourcing. Whatever the government must do, it must outsource. And so when you speak about accountability now, there'd have to be a commission that's appointed that will take about a year to run.
Millions,
people are
being
employed.
Money.
In fact, billions.
Yeah. Hey, it's crazy. But I honestly do believe that there needs to naturally be an unpacking of these allegations.
Yeah.
But largely, there are people occupying strategic positions that should not be there. Mm. That's why I say stepping down of these particular, not even the stepping down, the firing of these particular individuals without a package, you know, to say goodbye or a golden handshake should happen.
This whole thing about, on this, this whole thing about, hey man, time is flying. This whole thing about free education, maybe to finish off this whole concept of free higher education. You know, I saw something on Twitter a while ago, and this person, which we both know, was saying, there's a problem that came from this socialist view of the ANC in 1994 that came and said, free this and free that, free this. Yeah. But someone is paying for that.
The land
right?
of milk and honey.
Mm. The, someone is paying for that. Mm. So I know that, who's this guy that was SRC president at WITS, Dr. Something? I think he was also the founder of Tusanani Foundation. I'm not sure if you guys know him. I just forgot his name. But he I think he did, he wrote a couple of pieces on this whole concept of free access to free higher education. Because to me,
the cost of free.
Yeah. The cost of free.
Yeah.
There's a whole thing that must be unpacked there. Like, can we ever get to a place in South Africa where we get free, totally free higher education? I know that there are some countries that are doing it.
Germany and stuff like that.
You know, so, I mean, I don't know what you guys think, but for me,
basic education and a nutritional plan and get that right in South Africa. And then totally miss the mark in higher education.
I just want to
park that question there before I...
He mentioned something which is quite important, the issue of outsourcing within higher education. As long as the government, you're always outsourcing, there's competing business interests.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as there are competing business interests within higher education, we can never really get free education because someone must benefit. And most of the time, the person benefiting is not the students.
Yeah.
It's not the applicants to the institutions. It's these companies which stand to benefit, whether through the res business, the textbook business, the laptop business, because even Naspers is even there in the laptop issues. So everything in higher education seems to be feeding someone except the students. For me, free education is, in simple terms, the student must not owe anything. They must not owe money for tuition. They must not owe money for support, whether it be digital support like laptops, internet. The student must not owe Van Schaik bookstores. For
is
instance.
That feasible
so it
for us
is,
as a
for
country?
Me, if I can go to the clinic, get healthcare, go to the hospital, get public healthcare, and in that system and not be charged for the services that I'm getting, if we can achieve that, I'm sure we can achieve education and access into education. Because I can get sick now and I don't have a medical aid, but somehow I'm going to be supported. And for me, the issue has always been willingness. I don't think the government has any willingness to even get free education.
Not that there's no money.
Not that there's
and
no money.
Here's
it's
the
willingness.
Thing. You were, in your opening remarks, you make a statement that Bledsi Mande has said there'll be increments of university fees.
4.5% and 6.5% respectively.
Just to pose another question.
Mm.
A third of whatever you're paying in university, say for instance per module, I pay 3,500. A third of that is subsidized by the government.
Okay.
Why doesn't the government then increase their subsidy instead of increasing university tuitions?
Where does the money come
from? Willingness.
Yeah, willingness.
Where does the money come from?
as a country, how much is our GDP?
Tax.
So how much?
Tax more people so that more people can go to.
Because this is a cycle. They will then be replanted into the labor market.
There's even no guarantee of that because a lot of people with graduates
are sitting unemployed. True.
There's a huge problem. Yeah. Mm. This system is broken, guys.
Mm. No, currently, we don't have the capacity for free education.
Yeah.
And that is just a sad case because if we were looking at even tax brackets are exorbitant, they're too high. So we have to revisit those. We have to look at issues such as corruption in South Africa, and if that was minimized, how much money it takes. I think there was an article that was published, how much money it takes technically to run free education per year
as a country.
Yes.
And it does show that it is technically in an ideal state possible.
It's possible.
But if we are being realists, it's not possible in South Africa. But what is achievable?
Why not?
Naturally, because of all these factors that we are bringing up. Currently, that the ambitions and aspirations, our trajectory is not pointed towards that way. Because also there are so many external parties that play. Universities are a microcosm of society. But technically, universities should not be there solely to run for profit.
Yeah.
But there are professors that are releasing editions every other year so that, you know, more money can be pumped into the reselling of textbooks. Yes, it is their knowledge. It's postdoctoral studies, it's their contributions, but they get paid. You know, a paper that you publish in the university, there are certain brackets that you get paid by. So there are so many ways to be able to bring in money into a university besides just the textbook that the university or the student pays more money for. But also, just the price and the cost of education currently in South Africa is so high.
Yeah.
And then the question begs, if universities are not a place of income, why are they so high? You know, is it to build new buildings, green and eco-friendly buildings? Is it to introduce new curriculum? Are there new and innovative ways of learning for the cost of this increase? They increase by 6 to 8%. What is going to increase in the quality of my education? If the cost of my education increases by 6 to 8%, then what is increasing in the quality of my education?
Yeah.
You know? Because once I graduate, it's a totally different story for me tapping into, you know, the labor market. And that's a conversation on its own that still needs to kind of be tapped into. But then that question begs, and I think that what we need to get to do, one, there is not a well-knit-picked relationship between the university and the government.
Mm.
Because that needs to you know, further be understood in terms of what are the roles when it comes to the cost implications. Because universities have free rein in terms of how they run the educational material. But when it comes to the cost of education, and if a country like Zimbabwe...
It's regulated by USAKA.
Yes, by USAKA. But what I'm trying to say is, in the innovation, in the employment of staff and whatever the case may be, run it at your own free will, you know, as long as the outcomes of that particular education are USAKA accredited.
Mm.
But if a country like Zimbabwe can get that right, yes, it does have its challenges in terms of higher education. Why can't South Africa get it right? Zimbabweans... free higher education. There are Zimbabweans who go to England, who study at prestigious universities, who come to South Africa. Yes, yeah, sometimes there are payment delays, there are hiccups here and there. But if they can get it right, Zimbabwe, with its own challenges and its own GDP, and South Africa, the America of Africa, as some would call it, and it's a difficult term to swallow. The South Africa of Africa, if you may call it, as some would call it. But how can, again, it speaks to the question of willingness.
Yeah.
Is our trajectory there?
I don't know. So you're saying Blade shouldn't resign yet. He's done good. He shouldn't.
For me, he shouldn't resign. Let's allow the law enforcement agencies to investigate. Remember,
what has
Blade done?
That means we've lost trust in the law enforcement agencies.
We've lost trust in Blade.
For a long time.
I don't think law enforcement agencies. That would mean I'm not safe right here where I'm sitting.
We're not safe.
Let's get rid of Blade.
We're not safe. Someone made
a practical example.
We're not
when the city of Cape Town
Yeah.
Called the graffiti unit to paint over the
I saw that.
Yeah. Palestine. There were probably and I saw the video, there were probably over 10 cars that were there. And that's an area in the Cape Flats. Yeah. Have someone shot in the Cape Flats. How soon will they respond? How many cars will come?
Yeah.
We are not safe.
We're not safe. That's just...
If we've lost hope in the law enforcement agencies and trust, it's a serious problem. But what I can say is look at the case at the International Court of Justice. It proves that we can't lose hope in the judiciary system. Many people are critics of the judiciary system of South Africa, that you shouldn't trust the courts, you shouldn't trust the judges, even the attorneys, by the way, even the lawyers. But we've just seen counsels who are coming from South Africa representing us at the highest level and being able to put up a strong case.
Who are they employed
so
by? No one there works with the NPA.
They're speaking to this mic.
No one there works with the NPA. They work at Section 27. They are yes.
Section 27, that non-profit.
Yes. Ngaitobi is no longer now operating in his capacity. He was appointed as judge.
I don't know.
No longer working. Again, who are they working for? You've got university professors and the like. So who's working at the NPA there? Who is currently a constitutional court justice there? Who is currently a high court judge?
We mustn't forget, it's the government that sent them there. And that government is the very same one we're saying we're not safe.
Internally. They've done a brilliant job. Internally.
So there's some form of good things in this government. And that's why I'm saying maybe we do need to give them time.
Or
don't trust the law enforcement, let's take these allegations to the public protector. At least maybe because I know some people say Mkhwebane is a hired gun, like Mbalula. But let's assume the current public protector is not a hired gun.
Yep.
Maybe there's some hope. Let's take the allegations to her and let's see what comes out of that. For me, allegations must always be tested.
You know, what I take from what you're saying is there's good.
Yeah.
And this is, for me, this is in whatever discussions we're having in our small corners, wherever we live, we always sort of paint the ANC with one color, that there's bad.
Speak about the government.
Bad. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, government. Okay, distinction ANC government. But I, like what you're saying, I think that there's some good that has come out
100%.
From the government since that. 1994. And from time to time, applaud, recognize, and, you know, But I don't know. We're running out of time. I don't know any last thoughts on this. But this leads me to the final thing that I just wanted us to talk about. Because part of what you guys were speaking about was, in fact, part of what you were saying is that if we don't trust, if there's no faith in these institutions, then we're doomed. And we were saying, there's no faith. I don't trust. I don't feel safe. That's why I've got to build high walls. I'm being genuine. I really, really don't feel safe in South Africa. And there's a problem. There's something that's working. So, what can I do about that? It's 2024. Everyone will be voting. Obviously, we want people to vote. We want young people to vote. Something interesting. Which I read, this is also an article, News 24. This one was published last year, and they were looking at the newest stats in terms of new applications of people that just applied. And it says that about 78% of the new registrations were citizens aged between 16 and 29. I thought, wow. You know, 78% of the new registrations were citizens between ages between 16 and 29. Now that for me says, okay, if a majority of new registrations are young people, where are the young people now? Which party is capturing the vote of young people? That's, you know, you guys can comment on that. Which party is capturing the vote of young people? But also, I was looking at, for instance, the total number of people who visited the voting stations over the weekend stood at around 2.9 million.
Sure.
Right? 2.9 million. And that's what the CEO of the IEC said, right? But look at this, guys. Look at this. Out of Gauteng had the highest percentage of registrations. So Gauteng, KwaZulu-Natal, guess who's third?
Eastern Cape.
We showed up.
We're naturally, in terms of population, got a large number of people, but I think also people in the Eastern Cape are really, we've always been the forgotten province.
Yeah.
And I think it's been an unfair statement to make. You know, we're always coming last in matric results.
Yes, there's something problematic
about the Eastern Cape, but I think it does stand to reason that also in the Eastern Cape, we've also had our own internal issues.
Yeah.
You know, that we've been having. So I think it also speaks to that notion. I'm also excited about the local government elections 2026 in the Eastern Cape. I think
You'll be running or you don't know yet?
No comment.
So 2024, let's finish off with this, right?
Yeah.
So we've spoken about all of these things. For me, they are connected,
yeah.
Right? And as far as is connected to the quality of leaders that we have.
Mm-hmm.
I loved what you said in the beginning. Why are we not talking about young people? All of these people, we're saying these are old people. We didn't even speak about the Jacob Zuma and the MK thing, but they are old people. Ace Magashule is an old person. Jacob Zuma, 82 years, no? 82, 83.
Yeah, 80
and he's so active. I'm not sure if you guys saw him now going out.
He still has the songs.
He is so active. He's so, and but just now they were saying he's released
on hospital.
medical parole. But now Umkhulu is like going all over the country now canvassing, which is a whole other thing. But it begs the question that how should we be voting in this year's elections? I think we're about what, 2 or 3 or 4 months away. May, no?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
May, January, February, March, April.
I think the date is still to
be announced.
To be announced. But in terms of voting, I think there's a lot of options. Like one of the concerns I was having is how long the voters' roll and ballot will be. That's a serious concern for me because almost every week there's a new party. almost every week someone was fired from some party.
And
now they're thinking they're starting their own thing. But the choices is young people need to know what is a manifesto. They need to know what that party is offering.
I love that.
They need to know, like for instance, in terms of social issues, what that party is going to be doing to bring change. Who are its leaders? Mm-hmm. Because listen, if I look at the issue of state capture, some of the guys mentioned in those reports. Now, the same guys are going to parliament again and have to vote for them.
Yeah.
There's a problem there.
Is the list out?
Not yet. So I think parties are still organizing their provincial list, their national list. Those are some of the things that we need to look out for. We also need to look out for, are we represented as young people in those lists?
Of course.
Because that's a big question.
Think
one
of the problems is the sleepiest in parliament. You understand? I can't vote for another sleepiest, someone who's above 70 years, 60 years. They are supposed to be a pensioner.
So that's majority of ANC
parliamentarians. To argue for us policy issues.
Yeah.
So we need fresh people. We need brilliant minds. Yeah.
My thinking is that it's not that there aren't young people here.
Mm.
It's just that they're in the fringes. And it's very dangerous when you as a country or as a party put young people in the fringes.
Mm.
Then it means young people are not going to be in support of that party. And you already know where I'm going with this. So how should young people vote? I think personally, localize your issues. Where you are. Which party is actually serving your interests? Because at a national level, I may vote for one party, but I don't trust it locally. So I might not. Look at the local
you mean
and
what provincially.
Hey?
Because it's national elections now.
Yeah. But what I'm trying to say is localize your problems first and understand whether or not this particular party has served the interests within your local party. You know, have they been able to tap into regions and see how they're performing? Have they been able to hold mayors accountable. There were video clips of mayors that were going into houses and attacking people.
Yeah.
And,
I saw that.
You know, the African National Congress held those people to book. Mm. You know,
what happened? How?
He was suspended, as a mayor. In fact, he wasn't even suspended. He was fired as a mayor.
Is it?
Yeah. It was issued by Fikile Mbalula on his Twitter that he is no longer a mayor. You know, so what I'm trying to say is, we need to look at whether or not those things are being possible, whether these are being addressed, and that is one of the things, because the heart and the root of the problem is not, you know, the decisions that I've been taking at Parliament, but my livelihood and my safety in my local community. The issues that I have that are being addressed, and then you work your way from local to national. In terms of your interests, you then escalate your interests and see, is this particular government creating employment opportunities? And how are they now being accessed universally or nationally? You know, are these parties' manifestos speaking to where I am? Because from a national level, they are then going to be disseminated and implemented at local levels.
Ideologically, here's a question I want to pose to you guys. Ideologically, top three, ANC, DA, EFF. I'm not sure how the list goes now from there, but these top three. Then you get what? Action SA, new player now. And then you get Musi Maimane, Bossa. Then you get, which other ones do you guys
ACDP,
know?
ACDP.
ACDP.
ATM.
ACDP. Say about ACDP.
Remember, they're also represented in Parliament as well.
One seat, they've got one or two. These parties that have been there, for instance, I sat down with Bantu Olomisa. He's been there since I don't know how long. What impact has he made? I don't know. You know?
So let's speak about top five.
Yeah.
What's your concern around this?
What I wanted to know was, ideologically, where do you guys see them in terms of what they represent in their politics, right? ANC, DA, we know with EFF, we know they've been clear, left politics, you know, socialist organization. Let's put Action SA, because they've been really, really, a lot of people are saying these guys are going to shock a lot of people.
Rise? Do you want to put them there?
Rise! How can I forget? Rise. Yeah. That's six. Rise, Songa Sozibi, Rise. Mm-hmm. They have been everywhere. I was saying this to you recently, that everywhere you go, you see a Rise poster. I'm not sure if you've noticed.
I've never seen something like that. It's a new party, but everywhere. Look, it has some eyes. Kind of poster somewhere, and I'm like, are these guys really new? What's happening there?
These guys are dynamic, okay?
And then everywhere on social media.
It's a new party, but these people have mileage in politics.
Rise. You know? It could mean that they're doing something right.
Yeah, but it also could mean they got money, which we also need to know.
But
who's
guys,
really
that's
funding
how,
them?
That's
my concern.
EFF says money, they're getting funding internationally.
No,
why are they being funded internationally?
I'm not too concerned about who funds them. What I'm concerned is the mandate. You know? What drives your cause?
Yeah.
Because we can access money. And it's a good thing that they've accessed money to be able to mobilize, stand in their feet, and move. A lot of people. I'm sure Musi has had international funding, you know? But it is the cause, what implores you. For instance, I'll applaud him. He's one of the people that have been so consistent about education, man.
Yeah.
And I love that about him. And he's had his foot on the government's neck when it speaks about education.
Yeah.
So I think for me, if we're speaking about these parties and their ideologies, it varies. It varies tremendously, because there are some successes and there are large failures. And there are, it's almost as if
we're not looking at their track record. We just want to, in terms of ideology,
what do they speak to?
And that's where I want to end off. Two things maybe before you speak. One is, I think you were speaking about, I forgot this now. But you were speaking about, yes, international funding, and you not being worried about that. There's an influence. Surely there's an influence. If I give you money.
That's a big thing.
If I give you,
If I'm giving you money,
remember in the ANC conference, the Cyril Ramaphosa sealed envelope,
exactly
funding issue.
So I don't think you can say that you don't mind whoever's funding. You want mandate. Mandate. There's someone who's saying, Mhlambohlele Stellenbosch, who's saying, Nancy Jens. No, I'm giving you, for instance, here's
out of trust.
PA, Patriotic Alliance, Gating comes out and says, I was offered 200 million rands. Mm-hmm. And he says, I was offered 200 million rands by Rob Hessoff and his colleagues. And they said to me, in order for you to give you this, the requirement is Nancy Mandy to pull up.
Yeah.
Requirement is don't contest in the Western Cape.
And MK is also having similar allegations.
Yes, 1.2 billion.
They offered some billions in terms of not having any policy concerning nationalization. So money somehow influences policies.
Granted. And I'm not saying let's completely forget the conversation. I mean, we can't divorce it. We've seen how money has played an influential role in politics. We've seen it with the Guptas. We've seen it with Cyril. We've seen it with Jacob Zuma. We've seen it with a number of high-profile individuals. We've seen it in multiple parties.
Can National Congress, where are they in terms of their ideology?
For me, the ANC has always been about the National Democratic Revolution. It's about implementing policies of the ANC as agreed within the ANC conference. The development of MK is connected to issues within the ANC.
Okay.
MK is alleging, right, through Jacob Zuma, that the ANC has failed to implement its policies, like issues like nationalization of banks, the land, issues like health reform. They are saying all of those issues have not been done. And the reason that they have not been done is because someone has hijacked the CR17 or CR faction within the ANC. And so now they want to lean more towards the left. Mm. And that's the issue.
Currently, where are they? Are they on the left? Are they
the center? ANC, I would say they're more on the right now currently, because even Steenhuisen in the DA is saying if ever there's a coalition,
I'm willing to work with
CR. We've never seen Helen Zille even dream of working with Jacob Zuma. This means that the landscape in terms of politics has changed.
Yeah.
And it also means that even the ideology of the ANC has also changed
to
somehow be suitable to even the DA. Because how do they think they can work together? And I don't think the ANC is rejecting that call entirely, because they are not clear whether or not who they will consider to be coalition partners.
Mm.
And it's good to see MK being clear to say we can meet with ACT, we can meet with the UDM, we don't have a problem with meeting with the EFF. So it seems that there's almost like a black alliance, if we can call them the black alliance. If not, we can call them, there's a left alliance that seems to be emerging.
Yeah.
And they seem to agree on reform and nationalization, on fighting against outsourcing and privatization, things that we're seeing happening under the current government. But also at the same time, the ANC is saying these new blocs are corruption blocs.
Okay.
It's those who have been somehow fired, removed, and they're no longer eating, and now they're forming their own parties.
Yeah.
Maybe that's something to also look at as well, that
no longer eating.
To really look at, because you don't want to put those in power who can be a problem again when they are part of the government.
Yeah.
So those are serious issues to look out for. But for me, it seems there is some kind of emerging alliance between the ANC and the DA.
Sure.
And the Cyril Ramaphosa. I don't know for how long, but it seems there's an alliance. Even when I look at Action SA, they don't seem to have a problem working with the DA. They do differ on certain policy issues, but they seem to be agreeing that there needs to be a pact established with these opposing parties. For me, that would mean that even ideologically, there's not much differences between Action SA and even the DA.
Sure. These three, what do you guys think of these three in closing? Rise, Mzansi, Bosa, Musimaimane.
Mm-hmm.
You've spoken a bit about Action SA, but These are the three new kids on the block. Maybe MK as well. Let's put MK. Okay. Although I haven't read anything in terms of their policy.
I don't think they have anything out there besides the statements of Jacob Zuma and some rallies. But that's one of the concerns. They don't seem to have much material out there.
Yeah.
But they seem to be having like the views, like you are saying, on their website.
Yeah.
Which means there's some kind of interest that they're having. But I don't think they've given us enough substance as yet.
Patriotic Alliance 2, Max, I'll give this one to you. Patriotic Alliance 2. So what do you think of this? I'd say one thing on Patriotic Alliance. I was watching an interview that they did, and Gayton came out and said, this is not a democratic party. He said, it's a dictatorship. There's no voting here. You don't vote for a president. Mm-hmm. You don't vote for a deputy president. So it will always be him and Kenny Kunen forever.
Sure. Yeah. And they will elect, they will determine who goes into...
I don't even think they elect, they appoint.
They decide.
They decide, but okay, Pele.
Come through.
So they got rid of someone now just because they attended.
Yeah, Ubunkosi Ukhanyile, they fired him for attending the meeting of the MK, and he didn't request permission to attend that meeting.
From Gayton.
And they just fired him.
Man. But give this thing to them on borders, you know? I think this whole thing, I don't know what you guys think, but what do you think ideologically to finish off Rise Mzansi, PA, Bosa, Build One South Africa? Yep. Musi coming and saying, let's turn this whole electoral system thing upside down. What I like about him is that he's
been,
yes, he's been saying, let's partner on a local level, to your point about local politics, let's partner with local civic organizations, and which, you know, he's been doing that in Queenstown. They've worked with local, you know. Yep. Here they're working with Okusta Jack, which is a local party. Yeah. So that's what he brings on the table besides somebody else. So what do you guys think of these newcomers?
Okay, I'll speak about Rise and just, you know, there's a mixed pot of influential key individuals. I remember they came down here. We met up with a couple of guys. Makhasule.
Yeah, he told he was invited to a caucus.
No, we were just discussing. It wasn't a Rise caucus, man.
But it was.
It was just a group of individuals where, you know, he was in town. You know, and then we just gathered around. It was just lunch. Had coffee. What do you mean? Who was invited?
They invited high influential people.
I don't know about that. And I don't want to come out there and make it seem as if that was the case.
Yeah.
And that's why it wasn't even on social media. He wasn't using that as a strategy. But my point is this, is that it's really key individuals that I really respect. Yes, there are some questions. Yeah. A lot of them. Yes, there are some question marks in terms of them now cross-flooring and creating Rise as a party of its own.
Cross-flooring who? Cross-flooring?
A number of individuals. Makhashule, for one, was a DA individual.
So you got people from the DA?
You've got a mixed pot of individuals that have been in the political space for quite some time. But what I just want to say shortly is that for them, Rise Mzansi, I think they've done a lot for the dynamic youth of South Africa to show that there is capacity to lead. And I think what we've been needing in South Africa, we've been seeing it in a few sparks here and there. I think the DA was one that built up a good traction for placing young people in strategic positions. But they've shown that we have young people who can think, start, act, and deliver.
Yeah.
And who can mobilize. So I'm really proud of the fact that they've done that. The problem with these new kids on the block is that there is no built-up trust. We are a country that comes from so much hurt, so much pain. There's so much responsibility that we need to place on political parties in order for them to be able to ensure that the needs of even the most marginalized South Africans can be protected. You know, we're not a country that asks for a lot from government, but even the source of innovation is not in the hands of government, but it's in civil society and organizations and businesses. But we need to be able to understand that there's so much that still needs to be closed.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, we spoke about a scar that needs to heal, you know. It's dense. I mean, man, 1994 was 30 years ago. That's not too soon.
Sure.
Baba, it's not too soon. It takes a lot to build a country. Yeah. But then again, it's a trust factor.
Yeah.
It's a trust factor. It's the credibility factor. You know, they've crossed floor to start something of their own. When they were preaching stories and praises of former leaders that they've now turned against, you know.
Sure.
So that's the problem even with Action SA. You know, you've got individuals that were there, staunch leaders for a very long time, that were preaching the gospel that they are now dispelling.
Like who?
Herman.
What gospel is Herman dispelling?
The likes of the DA.
Yeah.
You know? So you're a staunch individual that speaks this message. You know, you've got Patriotic Alliance, where you've got individuals that, you know, were speaking, were removing, and that was a very good task for them in being able to identify border management control is not there.
I think kudos to
But yet aligned, and that has been circulating on social media. Yes, people may be grasping at straws, but are aligned to individuals and naturally a government that is oppressing people in Zimbabwe, you know, them being very close to Mnangagwa. A number of pictures have been circulating around Gayton McKenzie and his relationship with certain individuals in Zimbabwe that are in support of ZANU-PF. So that's where the question then begs, do we trust politicians or are they strategists that know how to string or how to play with our heartstrings, you know, to get us into the right atmosphere and then naturally advance their own interests? Politics will never be pure, but it's a trust factor. And in order to build trust in South Africa, you need to have enough mileage. And unfortunately, 2024 is not enough time for all of these new kids in the block to be able to, or rather any individual or group of individuals, to stand and say, you've earned my trust.
We people should vote. In closing, people should vote. I think that's the general message that we want to 100%. Put out. First episode of the podcast. Thank you. You guys have been so amazing. People should vote. People should get involved.
Yeah.
No matter who you vote for, just make sure that you vote. I think for me, that's important. Just make sure that you go out and you vote. You can decide who you want to vote for. There's so many choices out there.
They also need to register just before voting.
Register to vote, yes.
Especially young people, right? Because there's about more than 11 million people in the country who are not yet registered. Those people could actually decide the election. And this election, it's expected to be very close. So the more people voting, the better.
More young people.
The more young people voting, the better, because it's going to give us different voices. And maybe it might even give us a change in parliament. And so there might be a change in the country's direction. So we have to vote. We have to participate. We have to register. And we also need to become involved. If you don't want to be joining a party or so, there's even people offering to be independent candidates. So you may be represented in that independent candidate. You don't necessarily have to align to a particular group.
Yep.
So there are many options this time around that we just have to be part of it.
Yep.